You ready to worship?
Amen.
Not quite sure. Say this with me. God is good.
God is good.
Because he's God.
Because he's God.
And I am good.
I am good.
Because of God.
Because of God.
Father, I thank you for today. You've heard your people speak. We are good because of you. And if we are good because of you, then we owe you so much. We owe you so much praise and honor. And God, we want to give it to you today because you are worthy of all praise from your people. I ask you today to minister to us just exactly what we need. Give us, Lord, everything as we give everything to you. Amen. Thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your love. Thank you for the heart and mind to be in your house. We tell you we love you. Now we'll show you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Are you proud to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Give God a hand clap of praise this morning. Let's go ahead and get in the spirit of worship. You've heard the saying, today is the first day of the rest of your life.
Amen.
Anything you've done in the past is gone. You can't fix it. You can't change it. But today is the day you move forward in God. Amen.
Setting my heart and mind on you, Jesus.
Just like that. Just like the song says. I'm not going to worry about tomorrow. God's got tomorrow in his hand. All I got to do is live for him. So I'm going to live just like that. Amen.
Sometimes I think, what would people say of me when I'm only just a memory, when I'm home where my soul belongs? Was I love when no one else would show up? Was I Jesus to the least of us? Was my worship more than just a song?
devil's still going to come at you. Amen. You make that proclamation, guess what? What he always says, when you stand up for Jesus, you better duck, because here comes Satan. He's going to try to knock you down. Amen. And when life gets you down and the mountains seem too big, there's only one name you can call on. The King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the mover of the mountain, the chain breaker. That's Jesus. So call on Jesus if you find yourself in a spot this morning.
Oh,
This next song we're going to sing, the title says it all. It says, I will worship you. And in parentheses, it will say, on bended knee.
Amen.
On bended knee. Now, we're going to stand up today, and we're going to raise our hands, and we're going to worship God just like this. But in your spirit, fall on your face before God. Bend your knee, and in reverence to Him. We stand and we sing with our voices and we raise our hands, but our spirit talks to God on bended knee.
Amen.
Amen.
My God is faithful. My God is truthful. My God is boundless in all He is. My God is wisdom. My God is righteous. My God is vision for all who see. So I will worship You in the beauty and I will worship You for the things You've done in me. And when my life's complete, I'll place my crown at Your feet, and I will worship You on bended knee. My God is power, my God is glory, my God is ruler over all that is. My God is timeless, my God is justice, my God is mercy to the oppressed.
Father, this morning, that is what You desire of all of Your children, to worship You on bended knees with a broken, humble heart before You. And God, I pray this morning that You will let every one of us speak the words today from our hearts that we love You. Let every one of us today be able to say, God, that we trust You and that we want things done to please You and to honor You. Help us, God, to hear what thus saith the Lord in our hearts and not our heads. so that we can be ready and be prepared at that very moment when you will come in the twinkling of an eye. When we least expect it, let us be ready now for that moment. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today, God has given us another day to worship Him.
Amen.
Another day to lift up His name, and another day to hear what He has to say to us. I want you to open your Bibles to the book of 2 Kings, chapter 7. 2 Kings, chapter 7. Debbie, turn the lights on, please. You know, I have this real heavy feeling this morning that there are a lot of people around. There are people sitting here in this congregation. There are people watching over the internet today. That's just like we were. We had a light on, very dim. And that's how we're living our Christian life, very dim. And God wants to turn a light on so we can see. So others can see us and see Christ in us. And it's my desire today that you let God's word speak to you. It would be good if every one of us this morning would say in our hearts that this message is not for somebody else, it's for me.
Amen.
And listen to it that way. God has spoken to me this week, and this message is as much for me as it is for anybody in here. But we sure need to hear it, and we sure need to let God move. So, saying that, I'll tell you, it's good to have every one of you here. I thank God for you. God knows your every need. He knows your every care. God knows everything about your heart. And today, He just wants you to know He loves you.
Amen.
And that ought to be enough for any one of us. Any one of us. 2 Kings chapter 7. We're going to begin with verse 3 this morning. It says, "And there were four leprous men at the entering in the gate. And they said to one another, why sit we here until we die? If we say that we will enter into the city, then the famine is in the city, and we shall die. And if we sit here, we shall also die. Now, therefore, come, and let us fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall but die. And they rose up early in the twilight to go into the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp of Syria, behold, there was no man there. For the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us. Therefore they arose and they fled in the twilight, and they left their tents and their horses and their donkeys, even the camp as it was, and fled for their life. And when these lepers came to the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent and did eat and drink, and they carried silver and gold and raiment, and went and they hid it, and they came again and entered into another tent and carried thence also, and went, and they hid it. Then they said one to another, we do not well. This day is a day of good tidings, and we hold our peace. If we tarry till the morning light, some mischief will come upon us. Now therefore come, that we may go and tell the king's household. So they came, and they told unto the porter of the city, and they told them, saying, we came to the camp of the Syrians, and behold, there was no man there, neither voice of horse nor of man, but horses tied and donkeys tied, and the tents as they were. And he called the porters, and they told the kings it. They told the king what he had thus said. Father, open our hearts and minds. Let us receive this day your word, your truth, your life and your hope. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
When we read these words, we think about first the book they come from, 2 Kings. When you think about the book of Kings, then the first thing that should come into our mind is that this is a book about great men, about great kings of Israel, about the great things that they have done, how God appointed them, how God anointed them, how God placed them, how the kingdoms rose up, how God blessed every one of them. We think we'd read about the exploits of the great kings and the many things that they had done, the many victories they had won, the greatness of it, the grandeur of Israel, of Judah, the great things. But as we begin to look at this book, all of a sudden, we see something different. We see not the great kings as they were here, but in these books we find the story of the poor people, of the wretched, those that were distressed. They were in great despair. There were problems everywhere they turned. They were poverty stricken. They were starving to death. They were brokenhearted. They were broken their spirits. A sad, despicable, horrible scene that we see here. Not one of grandeur and one of great glory, but of one of great desperation. The Bible, if it took out the stories of the poor and the wretched, there wouldn't be much Bible left. Because from the front to the end is the story of those people that God loves and how they are ill-treated by the enemy of life. You read the 23rd Psalm, or you read the Psalms, and you see all throughout that book, David talked about despair and agony and pain and suffering all throughout that book. You look at people like Moses, a great man of God, but yet he was a man that was placed in a basket to die because his mother feared for her life. You see the story of Joseph, a bright young boy that was nothing but a young boy and didn't know some of the things he was doing, and yet hated and despised by his brothers and sold into slavery. And there he toiled, not only in slavery, but in prison and other places throughout his life. You see the story of Job, a great man, but yet the story of Job is the one who lost everything he had. His family, his friends, everything about him was gone. And we see him sitting in ashes before God, trying to figure out what in the world had happened to him. You see the story of Ruth, a great young lady that was raised by God, who comes to a foreign land, and there we see her begging for food. We see her out in Boaz's field, and she gathers those things that are left over, just the last stuff, not the good stuff. And we constantly see this type of attitude throughout the Bible. So it's not about great kings. It's about the people of the earth and the real things they do and how they lived. And in this story here, we see the nation of Israel, God's people. God had his hand on them. He was directing them. He was leading them. But yet, as this story unfolds, we see a nation that is shut up in despair, and they are wretched. They are hungry. There's a great famine, and there's great starvation going on throughout the nation. Elisha, a prophet of God, was a great man, and he was their prophet. And he was the one that came to them with the story of life and the story of hope. But we see him telling the truth. We see him telling the people what's going to happen. And I want to tell you something. Thank God for ministers who will stand in the gap for their people.
Amen.
I'm going to tell you. You don't understand the burden I carry this morning. Richard can understand it because he's been in my place. Brother Ed can certainly understand it because he's been in my place. But we carry a burden for our people because we understand there is but one breath away from life and death.
Amen.
One breath away from spiritual life and spiritual death. And it's our responsibility to bring forth a word that can help you prepare yourself and help you to get ready for that moment, because it's going to happen and it's going to be in a split second, in the twinkling of an eye, and we're not going to know it until it's all over with, and there'll be no praying in the grave. There'll be no preparation in the grave. Amen. What you are here, it's your last breath, is what you will face in eternity. That's God's word.
Yes.
And see, when we begin to share that word with you, it becomes a hard word. Many don't like it. They'd rather us preach a great word, an encouraging word, an uplifting word. Talk about heaven, talk about God, leave hell and the devil out of it. Don't let my conscience be burdened. Lift my conscience with a lie. We're all going to heaven. We've all got it made. We've all done this, and blessed be the name of the Lord, and it's a good day. Let's go home and eat. And everybody's happy and everybody enjoys it. Everybody walks out and says, what a great pastor we have. What a great word he spoke this morning. Oh, we need to give him a raise. But then when the man of God stands before you with a heavy heart and tells you there is a heaven, there is a hell, and there is a day of judgment for every one of you,
amen.
Then it becomes a different story. It becomes a different story. Elisha was that man. He stood before his people and he warned the people, be very careful of what you do. Be very careful of what you say. Be very careful of what you believe. Be very careful how you act. Be very careful what you do. Be very careful of what you think. Be very careful of who you associate with. Be very careful of the words that you repeat. Be very careful. And the congregation would say, amen. I'm very careful. I watch where I go. I watch what I do. I don't mess with them old sinners. And Elisha's heart was heavy because he knew they had not heard the truth. Oh, they heard it with their ears, just like every one of you are doing. You hear it with your ears. But you don't hear it with your hearts. And the sad part about it is Elisha was able to look every one of them in the face when he told them these things. And that's the sad part about this. I look at you in the face. And I can see many who are listening. I can see many who aren't. I can see you napping. I see your eyes so heavy you can't keep them moving. Open. But when it comes time to go eat dinner, your eyes will be wide open and your mouth will be wide open. But in God's house, you sleep. You see?
It's true.
I see it and it hurts.
It's true.
I see you when you're playing games. I see you when you're on your phone. I see you when your minds are miles away. And I'm sitting here trying to tell you the truth. And it breaks my heart. To have to look in your face and to know you're doing nothing but playing a game because you haven't heard. You don't know God. And Elisha said, be careful, be careful, be careful. And the people cried, we're careful, we're careful, we're careful. And they walked right into sin. Right into sin. They heard the message, love one another. And they went out and hated one another. Have peace in your family. And they went out and fought with their family. Husband and wives fighting one another. Children disrespecting their parents. Oh, but we're careful. We're careful. Preach the word, Elijah. We're behind you, Bubba, all the way. And his heart was broken because he knew it wasn't true. And the bad part about it was that those who were listening had to suffer just like those who were rejecting God. Because we're not immune to it. A Christian has the promise of a better hope. That's what we live by. Because we're going to suffer like everybody else. So God brought forth great doom upon Israel. An army came against them. God told Elisha, this is what they're going to do. Tell the king to do this. And the king did this and stopped the attack. So the enemy comes a different way. God tells Elisha. God tells the king. He does something. The enemy's been defeated. This went on time after time. And the king got so mad of the enemy, he said, who is telling someone our plans? And he called a meeting of all his generals and all the big shots. He said, somebody in here is betraying us. Which one of you are going out and telling the enemy what we're doing? Because every time we go to do something, they're already there. Somebody is telling. One of them spoke up. He said, no, sir. We're faithful. But Elisha, the prophet, God tells him everything you say. He even knows what you say in your bedroom. It's in the Bible. He even knows what you say in your bedroom. The most intimate place in your life. God knows what you say. God knows everything about us, every day, everywhere. God knows.
Amen.
And all of us should have said, oh me, not amen. Oh me, not all of us, I'll take that back. Most of us should have said, oh me. God knows what I think. Oh my Lord. God knows I'm a fake. I'm the one that doesn't know it. Oh me. Now, time moves forward. And Elisha warned them, but they wouldn't do it. So in comes another enemy. God tells this enemy, I want you to go and I want you to attack Syria. God told them. So they began to march with 100,000 soldiers. Jehoram is the king of Israel at this time. His country is in a famine because they disobeyed God. Ben-Hadad was the king of Syria. He was Ahab's son. Remember Ahab and Jezebel? He was their son. He was the king. He takes his troops, and now he's going to attack Israel. He surrounds the city, which was the tactic you would use. Israel couldn't go out. They couldn't come in. They couldn't go to the grocery store and buy food. There were, whatever they had is what they were going to live off of. And they lived off of that until it gave out. Now they're in starvation. There's a famine in the land. The Syrian army has them surrounded. There's nothing they can do. The king is distraught. The people are brokenhearted, distressed, and discouraged. They don't know where to go. They don't know what to do. And you see, that's the way it is with me and you. We get out here and we start living a life the way that we live now. We don't take God's word seriously. We don't listen to God. We get in here and we amen and we do all this kind of stuff the same way we do our songs. You know, we'll throw a hand up and we'll say this and that and the other. And it's words we're singing. And too much of what we do is just words that we're saying. And they ignored God. And God's word came true. Now they are hopeless. And many of us do the same thing. Situations in our finances get so bad because we've disobeyed God. God said, give this, and we didn't do it. It's okay. God says, you can pay me now, you can pay me later, whichever one you want to do, but you're going to pay me. Our health gets bad because we've not worshiped God like we should, and we haven't prayed for one another like we should. So our health gets bad because we haven't trusted God. We trust a doctor, but we don't trust God. So our health goes bad. Our relationships go bad because we take God out of our relationships. You know, we're quick to say, you know, what's wrong with our schools? We took God out. Yeah. Guess what's wrong with our marriages? We took God out. Yeah. Amen. Somebody can help me. See, we don't mind talking about the schools, but what about our marriages? See, we can handle them. We do it our way. We can scream at our husband. We can scream at our wives. We can scream at our family, but bless God, we're Christians. Really? You're blind as a bat.
Amen.
Spiritually. Our children are out there living among heathens every day of their lives, and how many times do we come and pray for them? We don't bother to come to a Saturday night prayer because we'd rather watch a ball game. But we want to come here on Sunday and give God our best. It's a show. We're blessed. We got plenty of money. We don't need God. See, we don't say that, but we live that way. And God knows it because God knows our thoughts. We'd rather go eat than pray. We'd rather go do something with our family than give God a little bit of time. And then you find yourself during the week not praying. Because if you don't care to give God enough time to come here on a Saturday night and pray for a few moments, you're not going to pray at your house. Don't lie to yourself. Don't lie to yourself. God, if you'll give me $1 million, I'll give you 100,000 of it. Don't lie to yourself. You won't even give him a dollar of the 10 you got. Greed. God knows our thoughts. He knows our hearts. He hears what we say. He knows when we're faking it. It's a show. And God knows it. We just don't. Because we think all is good. So we do all these ugly things out here in the earth to other people, to one another. And then we come back and say, I'm sorry. So everything's fine. No, it's not. Because your heart's still messed up. That's where the problem was. It wasn't somebody around you. It was your own heart.
Amen.
And it's our heart that keeps us from giving God time on Saturday night at prayer. It's our heart. It is our heart that is keeping people out of church this morning. It's their heart. Yeah.
This is true.
But we don't want to believe that. God knows I love him. I don't have to come and pray. I'm not going to do that until I need him. But you let something happen to one of your children. You let something happen to your mate. Let something happen to you. Oh, all of a sudden we find time to pray, don't we?
Yeah.
Because God is an instrument that is there devised for our use when we need him. And if we don't need him, I'm on my own. I got it. But I can talk a good talk. I can sing a good song. I can praise a good praise. But it's not coming from your heart. That's what he was telling Israel. Israel now is in trouble because they did it their way. And they're in starvation. There's no food. There's nothing. And they're surrounded by the enemy. There is no hope whatsoever for Israel. None. Later on, King Ben-Hadad of Syria mustered his entire army and besieged Samaria. As a result, there was a great famine in the city. And after a long while, even a donkey's head sold for $50, and a pint of doves dying brought $3. Now you get this picture. It is so bad they're eating their animals. And they're eating a donkey. And the head of a donkey, you have to pay $50 to get the head of a donkey to eat it. A pint of dove's dung. $3 for a pint. Now, some people say that dove's dung is just that. Others say it was a vegetable that's sort of like a pea that they grew back then. Most scholars say take it literally, just like it said. Because where will they be growing peas? It's a famine. $3. That's how desperate they were. They were in a famine. It didn't matter if the donkey's head cost 50 cents. They didn't have the money to buy it. How many of us are living in poverty today? Not poverty where we have nothing, but poverty where there are certain things we want and we need, but we can't buy them because we don't have the money. We got a house we hate, but we don't have the money to buy another one. We got a car that's run down, and we got to push it more than it pulls us, but we can't afford to buy another one. Certain drugs we need, but we can't afford to buy them. Need a new boat, can't afford to buy it. We're in poverty. Poverty is whenever you don't have something you need. You don't have the means. They were living in poverty. That was bad. A donkey's head, it was bad. But then, one day, as the king of Israel was walking along the wall of the city, a woman called to him. She said, "Help me, king! Help me, king! Help me!" And the king looked at her, and he said, "If the Lord doesn't help you, what can I do?" God forbid that his nation has become that. Right here in this body of people, there are some of us who do not have enough faith to knock a hole in a wet paper towel. Because we've walked away from God. We've done it our way. And now we've backed ourselves into a corner and we don't know how to get out. We've done it wrong for so long. Now it's desperation time. We're in famine. We're starving spiritually. We can't do it. And somebody cries out, "Help me." And we look at them and we say, "Call the preacher. Look, I got a special prayer. Put it on the prayer chain. Get somebody praying for me. Because my prayers don't get through. Got a word I need you to share." "No, go give that to Denny. He talks better than I do." If the Lord can't help you, what can I do? The picture of God's people today, who are supposed to be the light of the world. And we're so dumb that we don't know we've put a bushel basket over our light, and all we're getting is just a little bit of rays like we had a while ago before the lights came on. And we're walking around in darkness, groping, we're running into things and hitting things, and we're bleeding spiritually all over the place, but we're okay, we'll just put a Band-Aid on it and move on. Church, are you listening to me?
Amen.
Well, you got your heads down, you need your heads up. It'd be much better for you to listen this morning than to write something down. Amen. Listen to me, church. Now look at this. She said, "I have neither food nor wine nor drink to give you." That's what the king said. "The Lord can't help you, I can't. I don't have any food, I don't have any wine, I don't have anything to give you, I can't help you." And today people are coming to us spiritually needing help, and we're trying to give them physical things. Because we don't know how to give them spiritual things. We don't know how to pray for them. We don't know how to pray the prayer of faith. We don't know because we're living wrong. And we know we are. That's why it's hard for us to pray for somebody else. Because we know we're living wrong. Oh, we can say a few words over them. But do we have any faith to believe for God to do what we're praying for? No. But I prayed a prayer with them. Bless God. You see? Blindness. He said, "I don't have anything to give you. I don't have any food. I don't have any water. I don't have any wine. I have nothing to give you, so just leave me alone." And then she said, "This woman proposed that we eat my son, one day. So there were two women, had two children. They made a pact. We're dying. Tomorrow, we're going to take my son and kill him. We'll boil him and we'll eat him. That way we can live. And she said, King, I did that. I gave my son. We ate him, my son. We ate him, and now it's her turn. And she won't give me her son so we can eat him. Cannibalism. Cannibalism. They had gotten that desperate. And the king, in all of this, he said, God, kill me now if I don't kill Elisha this day. Now that just came out of nowhere. It's there, you can read it. God, strike me dead if I don't kill Elisha today. What did Elisha have to do with it? Because the king knew something about Elisha. Some scholars said that Elisha had told the king, it's okay, we don't have to battle them, we're going to be safe. But now they're starving and they're surrounded. Some say he told the king, maybe, don't go out and fight, God will fight your battles for you. Don't give up, God's on our side, God's going to provide everything we need. Whatever Elisha had told him, the king was so furious that they were in starvation to the point of cannibalism and surrounded by the enemy and fixing to die, that he says, I'm going to kill Elisha. And that is what many of God's people are saying today, spiritually. Kill the preacher. Yeah. Not talking about my blood. Shut him up. Let's get another one. I don't like the way he preaches. I'm not going back. He steps on my toes. He does this. He does that. And it's just not right. I don't feel right. I just don't feel good there. I want to go somewhere so I can get a real uplifting in my spirit, not walk out like I'm carrying a ton of weight behind me, dragging everything I have. I don't want to know the truth. Let somebody lie to me so I can feel good. That is the place of the church today. And I know none of us fit in that category because we're blind. I'll kill Elisha. So he tells one of his soldiers, go to Elisha and kill him. And the soldier goes to Elisha's house. Oh, but God knows everything you think. God knows every evil plan you have in mind. God knows whether you love him or not. Just remember, he knows. So God told Elisha, they're going to send a servant here to kill you. Don't answer the door. The king will be right behind him, and the king's going to face you. A few minutes later, knock on the door. Elisha said, don't answer the door. That's the guy wanting to kill me. Just leave him alone. In a minute, the king will be here. A few minutes, the king came up. Elisha, let me come in. So he brought him in. He says, Elisha, what's going on? He said, I told you. I warned you. And you wouldn't obey me. Your people wouldn't obey me. Now God has done exactly what he said. God never lies.
Amen. No, he doesn't.
If it's a sin to cheat, it's a sin. Lie, steal, fight, fuss, unrest. Sin. It was a sin yesterday. It's a sin today. It'd be a sin tomorrow.
Amen.
What about disregarding my word? Sin. What about not listening to the man of God? Sin. What about refusing to live the example that Christ left us? Sin.
Amen.
What about standing up for right in the face of wrong? What about it? He said, your people refused. Now they're in sin. Now this is God's punishment.
Amen.
But, King, I want to tell you something. Tomorrow, you're going to be able to buy a whole bushel of flour for a couple pennies. And barley, there's going to be barley to eat tomorrow that you can't imagine. You can buy a whole bushel of barley for a couple pennies. This is a land that is eating their children. And where are they going to get barley and wheat for pennies? Anybody can buy it. There's going to be so much of it. And the king's sitting there. In his heart, he's saying, yeah, right, sure. Remember Sarah, when God says you're going to have a child? What did the Bible say? She laughed. God knew her heart. What did Sarah just say? Oh, I didn't say anything. Liar, I heard you, God said. You laughed at me. The king laughed. Elisha said, it's going to come to pass. But I want to tell you something, king. You won't eat any. You won't share in it. Because you're going to be dead. And the king walks out. Now, church, that is the introduction to this sermon. It's a two-part sermon. Now, I'm smart enough to know that many of you won't be back tonight. That's okay. Because you won't face me in eternity. The Bible then for the Lord had made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses and the noise of a great host of soldiers. The moment that God promises us anything, He begins to work.
Amen.
I want you to hear that. The moment that God promises His children anything, He begins that moment to work to bring it about.
Amen.
That moment. So in chapter 7, it says that the Syrian army is there at night and they're camped out. And all of a sudden, God made them to hear the sound of horses. There were no horses. He made them to hear the sound. He made them to hear the sound of chariots. He made them to hear the sound of soldiers marching. He made them to hear. And He made them to fear so much that they got up and they ran. They put it in B for boogie and got out of there because they were scared. And they ran. All of a sudden, this story changes. And I love when it changes. It says, and there were four leprous men at the entering into the gate. And they said one to another, why sit we here until we die? Now, I'm fixing to bring this to an end this morning. I've given you the picture. Now, there's four lepers. They become the stars. They're sitting outside the gate. You know what a leper is. Unclean. Unfit. Death is certain. There's no escape from it. And these four lepers say, why in the world are we sitting here until we die? You see, when a village pushed them out, when a kingdom pushed them out of a city, they were on the outside of the walls. They had no form of income, no way to live, no food. So what the city would do is they would take their garbage every day and throw it over the wall. And the lepers would come and they would go through the garbage and eat. And that's how they survived. But all of a sudden, they're not getting any garbage. Because there's no food. They're in a famine. They're eating their children. So the lepers, all of a sudden, are sitting there with this rotting flesh. And they realize, we're getting no food. We're going to die. We're going to die from leprosy, this disease. Or we're going to die from starvation. But we're going to die. Why in the world are we sitting here until we die? And church, if every one of you could get this morning, that's the question you ought to be asking yourself. Why am I sitting here spiritually until I die? I'm going to die spiritually. I'm starving because I've not been receiving the food of the bread of life, the word. I've been rejecting it. I'm not hearing it. I'm doing it my way. I'm going to die because of the lack of the word. I'm going to die because of the disease I have, sin. So how am I just going to sit here until I die? God forbid. He said, if we go into the city, there's no food, so we will die with them. If we sit here, there's no food, we're going to die here. If we go to the army and go in their camp, they're going to take a sword and ram us through the moment we show up over there. So I'm going to die there. What's the difference? So let's figure it out. Sit here in misery, do nothing. Go into the city, misery, do nothing. Go to the army and at least die like a human being. So they chose to go that way. Every one of you this morning are facing the same thing. How are you going to die? You see, this is the part of the sermon where you don't want to hear it. How are you going to die? What about these sins you got in your life that you've been hiding? Not drugs, not sex, not porn. What about gossip? What about hate? What about fussing and fighting? They're sins. What about ignoring and disobeying God when God says, go do this and you haven't done it? What about unforgiveness in your own family? You can't stand your children, can't stand your grandchildren for the way they act. So you scream and you holler and you fight and you fuss with them. It's a sin. What about you children that are refusing to obey your parents? Doing things in secret they don't know anything about. Fussing back at it, talking back to them. It's a sin. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. What about parents that have not set a godly example for the children? Sin. So what about those things that we're ignoring? And because of that, we have a famine, not of food, but of spirit in our heart. Amen. You're just going to sit there and die? That was the question that they had. And I'm just going to sit here and die? Or can we at least die like a human being? And they chose to get up and go. Let us go. And to every one of you this morning, God is saying, get up and go. You're going to die where you are. At least try to get out of it. If you'll do something, I'll help you. Amen. If you don't, you'll sit there and rot and die in your sin, thinking you're holy, playing a game. Well, at least I'm this. No, you're going to die just like anybody else. You're going to go to hell just like any other sinner because you have refused God's word. And you've lied on top of that. Because you've lied to the Holy Spirit when you say, I love you. You've lied to God when you say, I love you. You've lied to God when you say, I'll follow you. You've lied to God. See, but we think it's okay. Are you just going to sit there and die? That's the question I'm asking every one of you this morning. Are you just going to sit there and die? Let it soak in for a moment. Are we just going to sit here until we die? And that's what's heavy on my heart this morning. We don't have the altars down here. But where you are is an altar. And I'm asking every one of you to use it this morning. This is not a game. And the devil's trying to stop you. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. We're playing recreation. Things are more important than God. Recreation. It's a battlefield, brother. You better fight that recreation. You better fight and get your heart, mind, and right straight with God. You better commit this morning. It's a battlefield, brother. Who are you fighting? The devil. Not one another. It's a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. It's a fight, not a game. Run if you want to. Run if you will. But I came here to stand. I'm going to make a stand this morning. I'm going to go. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it right. Because the moment's coming when it's all over. And then what? As I pray for you this morning, I want you to pray. God, forgive me from your heart. Search your heart. Search it this morning, church. It's not a time to lie to God. He already knows. So you fool us. Big deal. Unfortunately, you won't face us in eternity. You'll face God. While I'm praying, if you need Christ, while I'm praying, I want you to stand. While I'm praying, if you need to get this off your chest, I want you to stand. While I'm praying, if you're serious with God this morning, I want you to stand. And I want you to let God move in your life. It's time. Too much has happened in our church here recently. Too much is happening in America. It's coming to an end, church. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ this morning, God, I have delivered my heart. And it's a heavy heart. Because, God, you've placed me in charge of your sheep. And, God, I can see them straying. And I don't know what else to do. God, I've tried to be a good example. I've tried to preach the word. And I don't know what else to do. And I'm asking you, Lord, to look at every person this morning who is sincere. And I'm asking you, God, to have mercy on their souls. America is dying from starvation. The church is dying this morning from starvation. God, we're committing cannibalism. We're eating up one another. We fight and we fuss and we holler and we scream. We talk about, we lie about, we cheat on one another. Cannibalism. We don't even see it. Those two ladies didn't see it as wrong. They saw it as a means of living. Oh, were they so wrong? Because they committed murder. And God, you said that the tongue is the greatest murderer of all. Yet we do it so often and think nothing of it. This morning, as our people stand before you, God, I ask you that everyone that's lost and doesn't know you as Jesus Christ and Lord and Savior, that right now they say, Father, forgive me. For I've sinned. I pray for every person in this building to be able to say this morning, God, if there's anything in my life and heart that he's talking about, forgive me. I don't want to be full of sin. You've done so much for me, God. You've given me so much. I need to love you, and I need to give it back to you, and I give it back to you with my life by living for you the way you want me to. God, there is a heart in here that is hard with sin. I know that. And I ask your Spirit now to go straight to that heart and break that heart and let them realize, God, that the path they're on will lead them to hell. Their families following them, God, following them. You called us to be men of God, women of God, leaders, examples. And God, somebody is following all of us somewhere. I know there's one here, at least, God, that's leading their family straight into a devil's hell. Please, God, wake them up before it's too late. Help us all, God, to have your joy this morning. Because you helped us to see ourselves as we truly are. And we didn't like it. So we ask you to forgive us. I thank you for your forgiveness and for your love. In Jesus' name. Amen. A church, I want you to come back tonight. This is just the beginning of the example that God's given me in here for us. I'm asking you, please, come back tonight.